Spring. The ice is melting and the days are getting longer. Soon, anglers will be hitting the water in pursuit of walleye, one of the most popular game fish in Iowa. But walleye fishing doesn't just happen. While walleye thrive in Iowa's lakes and rivers, they cannot sustain their numbers through natural reproduction alone. So, each year, fisheries workers for the Iowa DNR carry out a statewide effort to collect and fertilize eggs and raise them in a hatchery so that walleye can be stocked around the state, a program that is funded by revenue from fishing licenses. At the Storm Lake Hatchery, last-minute repairs are being made in preparation for processing thousands of walleye. At any given time, there may be up to a third of Storm Lake's adult walleye population in the hatchery. So pump failures are not an option. Local managers have been tracking the progress of the spawn. Looking at the water temperature and the forecast, they're predicting that the peak of the spawn will occur soon, so they call for reinforcements. A few hours before the first nets of the season are set, crews from around the state start trickling in. For the next week or more, the hatchery will be their home day and night. The first order of business is deciding where to fish. Most netting locations are based off of 30 years of experience gained from netting Storm Lake, but sometimes wind speed and direction play a bigger role. A bowl-shaped lake formed by a glacier about 14,000 years ago, Storm Lake often lives up to its name as it provides little refuge from the wind. It's April 7th, and water temperature and day length, the two factors that determine when walleye will spawn, are just right. These fish will start making their way into the shallows in search of mates. Once they find each other, they'll swim side by side and simultaneously release their gametes, and the eggs get fertilized in the water.
You ready? Okay.
Walleye do not provide parental care. Rather, they broadcast their eggs in shallow gravel and sandy areas in hopes that some of them will survive. It's in the shallows where fishery managers will intercept the fish and catch them before they have a chance to release their eggs. While they attempt to spawn, Iowa's lakes have too much sediment and lack suitable habitat for good success. Under ideal conditions in the wild, walleye egg survival is in the single digits, but in the hatcheries, egg survival commonly exceeds 70%, and a lot of eggs are needed to get the 150 million walleye that are stocked around the state each year. But in order for all that to happen, the fish first need to be caught, and the crews use gill nets to do this. The net is staked at shore. Strong stakes driven deep will help keep the nets from breaking loose and getting tangled up with boats in bad weather.
Okay.
The net is then run out into the lake and creates a wall of fine mesh. As the fish cruise in the shallows looking to spawn, they get entangled. As you might expect, the fish commonly get caught around the gills, where their sharp opercle flaps easily catch in the net. By 7 in the evening, the nets are set. Then it's back to the hatchery to make dinner and wait. As the sun sets over Storm Lake, the walleye move in, and the crews will soon find out if the spawn is truly on. After 3 hours of soak time, the crews head out to run nets. The wind has picked up since the nets were set earlier, and there's now white caps on Storm Lake. The high winds make it difficult to find the nets in the dark.
Okay.
The first few feet of the net are empty, but soon the fish start coming in. The walleye are picked out of the nets and then put in a tank with oxygen.
Got a mouthful of web.
Small knives are used to gently work the fish out of the nets, cutting as little as possible to work the fish out, as the nets will have to be used for the next several nights.
Not quite right, pretty soft.
While the nets need to last most of the season, they do take a beating when fish, after fish, after fish, comes in the boat, right up to the very end.
Holy cow, yeah!
After the nets are run, they are reset, and the boats head back to the hatchery to unload the fish and take inventory of what everyone caught. the boats return to the hatchery, they take their turn unloading the fish. Here, the fish will be sorted out.
Green.
A green female is one that is full of eggs, but they're just not ready to release them.
Right.
A ripe female has eggs that are ready to go. The fish are counted so an inventory of the hatchery can be kept. This will help crews predict the egg take for the next day. With one boat unloaded, the next one in line backs in. Some gentle pressure on the belly will tell if the fish is green or ripe. There's lots of green fish, but that's okay. Many of those will ripen up in the coming days, but some never will.
Green!
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 Finally, some ripe fish. These are what the crews need to guarantee a good year of egg harvest.
Ripe!
As fish start to fill the tanks, it's clear that it's shaping up to be a good year. Crews will go back out a second time to run and pull nets and unload fish all over again. They usually get done around 2 in the morning. This process will continue for another week or more until the egg quotas are met or the fish quit spawning. At the end of the night, a final tally will be made so they can track their progress towards Storm Lake's goal of 300 quarts of eggs. Then, it's back to the hotel for some quick sleep because there are a lot of fish to go through the next day. By the third night of the season, crews are capitalizing on the big ripe females and enjoying calmer weather.
Really good sized fish. Ooh, that one's ripe. Perfect.
But conditions can change fast. By the fourth night, a lightning storm moves in, and crews have to run nets between cells. The next night, a hailstorm takes crews by surprise, but the fish keep coming in.
It's getting sporty out here, folks.
The next day, a power outage forces the crews to start the backup pump and strip eggs in the dark. But amid the long nights and days, bad weather and other mishaps, the crews find humor in the surprises found in the nets.
Green.
At about 8 in the morning, the crews start sorting through the green fish from the night before. About a third of those fish will eventually ripen if the water warms a few degrees. If it doesn't, it'll hurt the egg count.
Ripe.
The fish that ripened are held in keeps to minimize any more handling and reduce stress, and there are a lot of them.
So we just sorted through all the fish. We got 271 females to strip today. It's gonna be a long morning, but we're gonna get a lot of eggs. We're hoping for 120 quarts maybe. It should be a really stellar day, so time to get suited up and start going to work.
The egg collection process is fairly simple, but every step is important. The fish need to be completely dried before their eggs are removed. If any water touches the eggs, they'll open up, and if they don't get fertilized within 30 seconds, they will die. The eggs are expelled by gently rubbing the belly into a dry tub. The tubs are then packed into coolers and prepared for transport. Once the eggs are harvested, the fish is measured and given a tag. The colors tell what year the fish was caught.
Black.
This particular fish is a regular.
Orange.
She has been caught 6 years in a row.
And red.
After the tag, the fish take a ride on the water slide and go back into the lake. The egg collection process can drag on into the afternoon, depending on how many fish there are to go through.
Today, we're going to be sending off 114 tubs. So usually that equates to about 1 quart per tub after the eggs are water hardened. So we're looking at a good possibility of 100 plus quart day, so it's great.
The eggs are carefully loaded into a van and driven to the bigger hatcheries to get fertilized each day. At the start of the season, the eggs are sent to the Rathbun Fish Hatchery. But as that hatchery fills, the eggs are directed to Spirit Lake. Once all the eggs are loaded, the nets from the night before have to get straightened out. Once everything is cleaned up, the crews go back to the hotel for a few hours of rest and get ready to go back on the water for another night. By the seventh night, water temperatures have increased and there's a lot of empty net and only a few walleye. An increase in bycatch, such as gizzard shad and common carp, are telltale signs that the walleye spawn is coming to an end.
So the catch has really dropped off, things are winding down, and so we're calling her quits. We've been here 7 nights, guys are tired, ready to get home, get some sleep.
2 down, 1 to go. Last net of the night, possibly last net of the run. Beautiful night on the east shore of Storm Lake.
Even though the weather is nice and it makes work easy, it's no longer worth it to keep crews working for a minimal amount of eggs. The last nets of the season are pulled, and the crews are looking forward to going home.
That's it and that's all.
The next day, the last fish are processed, all the equipment is cleaned, and the Storm Lake hatchery is shut down until next season. The final count from the Storm Lake hatchery was 473 quarts of eggs, one of the best years for Storm Lake, and a great year by all accounts. The eggs from Storm Lake are shipped up to the Spirit Lake hatchery to get fertilized. Inside, more walleye collected from the Iowa Great Lakes wait for their turn in the spawning process. The eggs will be harvested from those fish and fertilized along with the eggs from Storm Lake. Semen taken from the males the day before is used for the fertilization.
Okay, so what I'm doing is adding the extended semen to the eggs. And then what I'll do once everything is properly mixed, I'll add about 1,000 milliliters of water to activate everything. This will start the semen swimming and the pore of the egg to open up.
So the eggs have been fertilized and then they go into a bath with some clay. The eggs are naturally very sticky when they come out of the fish for adhering to rocks on the bottom of the lake or the river. And so this clay just takes that stickiness off of the egg. We just do this for a few minutes, and then those eggs will go on to into some fresh water over here to the side. And after that 4-hour period, it's called hardening, then the eggs will go up and be handled and put into batteries for incubation.
Once on the battery, the eggs gently tumble as fresh water passes over them. As the eggs mature, they darken until eventually the eyes develop and it gives the eggs a black appearance. In about 18 to 24 days, the eggs will hatch, depending on the water temperature. And the fry, which are about the length of an eyelash, instinctively swim upwards. Their destination is the catch tank, to where they arrive by swimming out the jars and following the flow. The fry are then harvested from the catch tanks, and then loaded onto trucks where they will be shipped across the state and stocked into various lakes and rivers. Once the fry hatch, they have about 4 days until they absorb their yolk sac and need to start feeding. So stocking fry is a daily task during the peak of the hatch. These particular fry are headed to Storm Lake, almost 14 million in total. The odds are stacked against these little fish, but the few that survive will grow, and if they're lucky enough to reach adulthood, in about 3 to 5 years, their eggs may wind up in the hatchery to continue the cycle.